One of the greatest ways of keeping people under control and asleep and ignorant is to implant upon them a sense of what's possible. You do this by keeping from them all the information, the scientific information, esoteric information that shows that what is possible is vastly greater than what is perceived to be possible. But if you can get people to think, no, that's not possible, when people start talking about this is happening in the world and this is how they're doing it, people immediately go, that's ridiculous, that's not possible. What they're saying is they don't believe it's possible, not that it's not possible. And thus they dismiss explanations of the world on the basis of what they've been programmed to believe is possible, which is basically what you can see, touch, taste, and all the rest of it. And the area that it might be good to talk about in relation to this box is something that, in my view, this is fundamental to why that is. Of course, I'm sure you've talked many times on this program about, indeed, there's a History Channel series now, Aliens the Series, or Ancient Aliens the Series.
Right, yeah.
One of those programs was entirely about this phenomena that I've been writing about for so long, of this common theme around the world in almost any culture of how some non-human race or non-human group manipulated human genetics. And I am absolutely convinced that this is what happened, Enric, in terms of the theme of the story. I would say that at some distant point in how we perceive time, of course, which is another illusion, human society was very much along the lines, in many ways, of that which was portrayed by the Avatar movie. You had the blue people on the moon, the Pandora moon, and they were aware that everything was connected. They communicated with the natural world, they communicated with the animals, and they were at a much more expanded level of consciousness, and their range of frequency that they could decode into holographic reality, if you like, was much, much wider than this almost pathetic, tiny frequency range that we can now decode into any kind of physical reality as we perceive it, known as visible light, which is so tiny it's almost laughable. And then in the Avatar movies, along came these in the film, they were American military people from the sometime in the, into the future, with their high technology, or what passed for it. And this was a completely different mentality. They came in with their technology. They had no perception of the connectedness of anything. They were all left brain, everything apart from everything else. Their values were not this beautiful interconnected world, but hey, there's resources under this blue people's buddy society that are worth a fortune. So let's go in and get them and smash it all up and take the resources. Mm. If you take that mentality portrayed in the Avatar movie to be, the reptilians coming in, I would say that that's very, very symbolic of it. And also, interestingly, in the Avatar movie, by its very nature and name, there was the concept of the American military, i.e., I would say the reptilians and other non-human groups, that infiltrated the blue people society by taking on an outer shell of the blue people.
Yeah, yeah.
So that they could infiltrate that society without the blue people having any idea they were being infiltrated. Now, all those themes, Henrik, I think are absolutely what happened to Earth. There was an infiltration, there was a hijack, fantastic geological events which basically wiped clean the and deleted the previous society was all part of this. And I have to say, someone sent me an interview you did with somebody called Troy something. I think Troy.
That's right.
Who was mentioned in his interview that that I was caught in the idea that this solar system has always been as it is now. I mean, my jaw dropped. I mean, that's ludicrous. I mean, I've been writing about the Velikovsky view of great cataclysmic events which moved all the planets, etc., about almost from the start, right back into the 90s, and right. I think that happened in concert with this hijack, and I think the original one was much further back than some people believe, but hey, that doesn't matter. The fact that it happens is the point.
Right.
And then the genetic now they've got a blank sheet of paper, or in effect, and the genetic manipulation started. And this is what I'm suggesting happened. You know, depending on the scientists you talk to, they say that something between 90 and 98% of human DNA is what they call junk DNA or non-coding DNA. And the word junk came because they didn't know what it does. And most of it, they still don't know what it does. And the idea that between 90 and 98% of human DNA has no function is ludicrous. I'm suggesting that actually what is within non-coding DNA, which they're now using as a term much more because it's becoming even ludicrous to them, that it doesn't have any function. And of course, open-minded, cutting-edge scientists around the world, particularly some in Russia, have concluded that non-coding DNA has its own language, as they put it, and it's different to the DNA that we think we know about. And I'm saying, actually, that within junk DNA, you have the inserted biological equivalent of software programs, which are driving human behavior and human perceptions. And from that, that software inserted, implanted within non-coding DNA, come human personalities as we perceive them. I found it interesting that people like Carl Jung and other psychologists and psychiatrists over the years have claimed that they could break down human personalities into 12 major, more than that, yes, but 12 major archetypes and combinations of them. Now, when you're dealing with all possibility, the great forever that we really are beyond this illusory nonsense, then that's obviously the idea that you can break down human personalities into a group of archetypes and combinations. That's ridiculous. Mm-hmm. But what can you break down into a few archetypes and combinations? Software programs, personalities, traits, emotional traits and responses and reactions, which are actually running within the human genetic structure. Now, I also found it interesting that I read so many accounts, Henrik, of near-death experiences that people have had, which included words to the effect of, when I was outside the body, I didn't feel emotion like I did within the body. Mm-hmm. I didn't have human emotion. Doesn't mean they were kind of cold or anything like that, but the human emotion they did not have of the type that we
experience. It's tied to the body. It's tied to the genetics, those emotions. Yeah.
Yes, that's what I'm saying, that these emotional programs were implanted during this genetic manipulation of the human form, which went on and is recorded by all these ancient cultures. And so, if we are only perceiving reality from what I call body-mind, which is the holographic form and the energetic fields that interact with it, body-mind, and not opening that and allowing the greater self in, consciousness as I call it, which is operating and perceiving and observing from beyond this realm of our experience currently, then I suggest that it is very possible, and I think it's very common, shall I say, that people can go through an entire human lifetime without having a single original thought or emotional response that has not come from within this software or externally manipulated sources. And therefore, when you're in that state, you become incredibly predictable. And when you, it's like, you know, if you type information into a computer, you know what that computer's going to do when you press enter, because it's programmed to do that.
Yep.
And in the same way, as you type information into a computer, that's symbolic in the human experience of the various situations we find ourselves in. And when you go around the world, of course there are exceptions, but generally, if people of different cultures face the same situation, it's almost like pressing enter. You pretty much know how they're going to respond. And if you take it to this other aspect, I was speaking earlier about the fact that these entities feed off human low vibrational emotional energy.
Mm.
Well, by putting the emotional program within the body-mind biological computer, as I see it, all you then have to do, Henrik, is to create a society which by its nature is constantly triggering the emotional responses within the software.
Mm, yeah.
And what's that doing? It's turned humans into producers of the very energy that these entities use as a power source. So when in the Matrix movie you had the Morpheus character holding up the battery and saying, basically summarizing, that humans have been turned into one of these, that is a profound truth in my view.
Mm.
And so if we are going to get out of this enslavement, and this is why the control system is terrified of this, we need to open our minds to allow consciousness in. And when we, and to do that, we've got to put aside all these preconceived beliefs, preconceived ideas, which act like energetic firewalls and sensors to stop us being influenced by the greater self, and we become isolated in terms of our point of attention into basically five sense reality. And when we are enslaved inside five sense reality, we are in the very stadium which these entities have created and thus are experts at. And so when someone opens their minds to consciousness, they then begin to perceive the world differently because their point of attention has now been dramatically expanded. Yet, yes, they still have a point of attention in the five senses because that's how we interact with this reality, but it's expanded out into consciousness. And thus you see the world in a much more expanded way. You can see things you couldn't see before. You can see how the dots connect, because all you could see was individual dots before that seemed to have no connection. And suddenly it's like, whoa, I never saw this before. And what happens then is those that are still being played by the program, they listen to these people and look at these people, and all they can respond with is, you're crazy. That's ridiculous. That's impossible. You want a psychiatrist, mate, because they literally can't perceive what you're perceiving. There's that great line, I think it's from the writer John Milton, who said words to the effect of, you know, the dancer and the dance. You cannot understand the dancer if you can't hear the music that the dancer is dancing to. You just think they're crazy, dancing for no reason. And so you see this awakening, Henrik, that's going on now as people are teasing out of this program version of self and the world, and they're starting to move that point of observation, and we call it an awakening. What is actually it is breaking the bubble that most people live in, which keeps a consciousness out.